Well, good morning and welcome to worship here this morning at Heritage Christian Reformed Church. It's a joy to be together, and it's a great privilege and blessing to worship our God here in this place. We gather like this because Christ has granted us access to the Father. The book of Hebrews reminds us that Christ has made a way for us to come before God's throne of grace, and He is the one who calls us to worship. And as we come to worship, I invite you to stand as we hear our call to worship in a responsive reading this morning from Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For He founded it on the seas and established it on the waters. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in His holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to an idol or swear by what is false. They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God their Savior. Such is the generation of those who seek Him, who seek Your face, O God of Jacob. We come this morning to seek the one whose face is beautiful and wonderful and for whom this whole world belongs. So let's join our voices as we sing together, "This Is My Father's World." People of God, He reigns. And so let your hearts be glad this morning. And in that truth, as we continue our time in worship this morning, receive also God's blessing on our time together. Grace to you and peace from God, who is our good Father, and Jesus Christ, who is our great Savior, and the Holy Spirit, who is the great comforter to those who mourn. And together God's people say, Amen. And let's continue this time in worship as we begin with the song, "How High and How Wide." seated. Well, the sing of this one who is our Redeemer is to hear the invitation again as God's beloved to come to Him as we are. And when we do so, we hear the words of the psalmist who models for us a transparent faith in the face of all of life. These words from Psalm 139. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. People of God, that is the promise that God gives to His children, even as we turn to Him in a time of confession. I invite you to join me in a prayer together. Let's pray. Eternal and merciful God, You have loved us with a love that is beyond our understanding. And through Christ, You have called us into the straight and the narrow path. But we have been anxious. There have been times when fear has gripped our hearts and we have strayed from You. We have sinned against You in thought and word and deed through what we have done and honestly through what we have left undone. Yet we remember this. And that is the work of Christ on our behalf and the gift of baptism in His name. And so we pray that by Your grace You will forgive all of our sins and lead us in the way everlasting. In Jesus' name, amen. Hear the good news for those who are in Christ. Your sins are forgiven. We read these words in Micah, one of the prophets in the latter part of the Old Testament, speaking to a people who have transgressed God and sinned against Him, and yet these beautiful words of grace. Micah 7, verses 18 and 19, the prophet says, "Who is a God like You, who pardons sin and forgives the transgression of the remnant of the inheritance? You do not stay angry forever, but delight to show mercy. You will again have compassion on us. You will tread our sins underfoot and hurl our iniquities into the depths of the sea." People of God, Jesus is both the one who justifies and is the justifier. And one day, we will stand before the judge. But it will not be a day of fear for those who are in Christ. What comfort do we have on that day? Well, we profess that in Heidelberg Catechism, question and answer 52, and invite you to join me in reading the answer to this question. People of God, how does Christ's return to judge the living and the dead comfort you? In all my distress and persecution, I turn my eyes to the heavens and confidently await as judge the very one who has already stood trial in my place before God and so has removed the whole curse from me. All His enemies and mine He will condemn to everlasting punishment. But me and all His chosen ones He will take along with Him into the joy and the glory of heaven. This is our faith. And the wonder of God's grace as it draws us to Christ is that as His children, it's an invitation yet again to have our walk shaped by the risen Savior. Let's make that our song of commitment as we sing together, "Father Long Before Creation."
Thank you.
As we continue our worship this morning, invite you to open a Bible with me now to Psalm 46. You'll find that on page 595 in your pew Bible this morning. Encourage you to open a Bible as we look particularly at this passage and see the imagery that the psalmist presents for us this morning. What would it mean if because of our faith in Jesus Christ, and I recognize in saying that not everybody shares that faith perspective, but if you do, and if you don't, I hope you see what it can be. What would it mean if because of our faith in Christ, when we hear the words of Paul in Romans 8, we take them to be true? And when Paul says, if God is for us, who can be against us? What would it mean if we could and should take that very truth? We're going to do that this morning as we look at Psalm 46, that if God is for us, who can be against us? If we took that, held it, embraced it, and then faced the troubles of our world. Because it's an astounding truth claim. Now, God's irresistible grace has been such that for countless centuries, there have been so many who have embraced it not just as a probability, but as a reality in their faith journey. And those who've gone before us have faced realities that are very difficult. And in God's irresistible grace, it's been such that this same truth, that if God is for us, who can be against us? This surpassing reality has been the unshakable foundation of faith. It helps to shape us. It helps to define Christ followers. And as we look at Psalm 46 together this morning, I hope, I trust that the Spirit will do this. We're going to find the same truth deep within us, that if God is for us, who can be against us? Our passage this morning is Psalm 46. Before we hear from God's Word, let's pray for a few moments here and invite the Spirit to be present in this time together. Let's pray. Come, Holy Spirit. Renew our hearts and our minds, our eyes and our ears, our feet and our hands, our very souls as we spend time in this precious word this morning. You have loved us before, long before creation, and you will love us long beyond it. And in all of it, may our hearts be content to spend time here at your feet. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Invite you to stand for the reading of God's Word as we do here at Heritage Church as a way of honoring that this is God's Word for His children, for His people. Psalm 46, let's follow along. God is our refuge and our strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice. The earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see the works of the Lord, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. This is God's word for us this morning. You may be seated once again. 20 years ago, a fledgling body of believers continued to gather faithfully and in a less than hospitable context. And through their tenacious witness to Christ, 20 years later, they actually became known as one of the fastest growing churches in the world. One person describes it as a unique community of possibly around 2,000 believers spread over a bit of a geographical area. What makes them unique is that most of the members are 40 years and younger. And the majority of them are Muslim converts. And what also makes this church unique is that it's located in Afghanistan. Which is why, like you, as I watched the news this week, and as we heard about what was happening in Afghanistan, and this news reached us of the Taliban taking over that nation, it's no small thing that organizations such as Open Doors USA, they alerted the universal church, the church around the world, they alerted us to the fact that our family was in trouble, our brothers and sisters in Christ in that nation. Blog I came across this past week, an author shared how he came across a Facebook message of a friend from the United Kingdom. And he shared that his parents had been missionaries in Afghanistan over the past 10 years. And he wrote this of the experience. He said, they have led countless people to Jesus, most of whom will meet him in the coming days. And he went on to write how their family was in hiding, surrounded by gunfire and bombs, and yet he said this about them. He says, my mom and my dad are full of peace and joy. How's that possible? How is that possible? Based on news reports, and I know I'm not even up to speed on all of it, it's fair to say that things for believers in Afghanistan are not easy today. So how is it when trouble comes and the sons of Korah, who penned the words of Psalm 46, they're going to paint three scenarios for us, three troubling scenarios in life. How is it when trouble comes and meets us that those whose life is in God or in Christ are not swept away? How is it that they can be filled with peace? How is it that they can know joy? And maybe you're in a troubling spot, and maybe peace and joy seems a little absent from you. And I trust as we look at Scripture this morning, we're going to see why it doesn't need to be that way. So here in Psalm 46, the sons of Korah, who were understood to be sort of the worshiping leaders of God's people in those days, they capture what I think are three troubling scenarios. And the first scenario is when the world falls apart. The first scenario is really the unmaking of creation. It's the earth, or the firm foundation under our feet. It's the earth giving way. Or it's the mountains who have withstood all that nature has thrown at them for millennia, and they're crumbling. I mean, there's just no way to fully grasp, I really believe this, there's no way to fully grasp the traumatic picture of these words. But for those who have been there and are there, who feel like our world is falling apart, we know. This is what it feels like. As it sometimes feels when life falls off the rails, or when the earth moves under our feet, when what you thought was stable, and that's the image really of the psalmist, right? When you thought was stable, the mountains, even they begin to crumble. And yet the faith of the psalmist sings, right? When your world falls apart, here's the faith that says, God, Yahweh, He is my refuge. God is our refuge and strength and ever-present help in trouble. Effectively, Psalms are saying, neither the ground on which I stand or the mountains that look so unmovable, they are not my refuge. My hope is not in them. My refuge is God. And it's not just that God is a provider of refuge. The psalmist is saying here, it's very concrete. He's saying, God is our refuge. And he doesn't just provide refuge, right? He is. He is the refuge. And sometimes when everything seems to be falling apart, what faith also professes is that he's stronger, right? That's the strength. He's my refuge and he is my strength. Man, so many times I feel like I bring this up, but you know, I tend to read a lot and some family and some of people I don't know, and I often hear them, you know, just be strong, right? And I love the sense and the call of standing firm, but I'm not sure that's the philosophy behind some of that statement. Because a follower of Jesus Christ says, it doesn't matter how strong you are. Of course, be strong, but ultimately, it doesn't matter how strong I am. What I need to know is there someone stronger? Is God stronger? And he is. He is my refuge, and he is our strength. So that when my world is falling apart and when that trouble comes, this is the first scenario the psalmist is painting, when the trouble comes, I will not fear, we will not fear, because, well, God can't be shaken. I mean, think of the imagery, right? The earth, the moving of that earth, the crumbling of the mountains, the surging of the seas, and there is one who stands unmovable, and he is my refuge. He is my strength. He is my ever-present help. That's the first scenario. Here's the second one. The second scenario, really, in Psalm 46 that the sons of Korah paint for us is a troubling one, and that is, what about when we're under attack? Really, it's a picture of a city under siege. It's an image of, well, when the trouble is all around us. And in that scenario, the psalmist says, well, there's peace in the city. I've never been in a literal siege situation, though sometimes council meetings can feel like that. I'm kidding. That was a lame joke. But sometimes, right, we're not always in that moment, but sometimes all the trouble is out there, right? It's out there. Whether your heart is aching for a world that seems to be just messed up. So why is there peace in the city? Well, there's a river in the city. And it's because God dwells in the city. I mean, there's the source of life. There's death at the gates. There's destruction and chaos and pandemonium. Just think of all the words you can use. But where God is, there is peace. Paul captures this for the Christians today. I thought of this passage as I prayed this week for my brothers and sisters in Christ in Afghanistan, and it goes for every place where allegiance to Jesus is very troubling. And Paul says in 2 Corinthians 4, he says, we are hard-pressed. And that's why this passage came to mind as I thought about these verses in Psalm, right? You're under siege, and there's pressure. We are hard-pressed, says Paul, on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. How is that possible? I'd like you to take out the Grace Altar hymnal for me with a minute. Turn to page number 469. I want you to look at this. Some of you know that Psalm 46 was the inspiration behind Martin Luther writing this beautiful hymn, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. And look at verse 3 for a minute. Right? He's a beautiful picture of God being our strength and fortress and not relying on our own strength or anything. And then verse 3, and though this world with devils filled, so there's that pressure. Paul talks about this in Ephesians 6 when he encourages us, calls us, put on the full armor of God because the devil is at work. There's so much. But even though this world with devils filled should threaten to undo us, we will not fear. For God has willed his truth to triumph through us. And that's the image there of a river being in the city of God. The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure. For lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fell him. And then the next verse tells us who that word is, right? And that's Jesus. Psalm 46 is the inspiration behind this amazing hymn of faith, but it's this verse 6 which is behind these specific words of the third verse of the Mighty Fortress, right? Nations are in uproar. In other words, man, it's so awful out there. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice. The earth melts. That's why peace dwells with those when trouble comes. God is within us. His voice silences fear. So we've had two scenarios. One, when the world's falling apart. Two, when there is pressure all around us. And now let's look at the third one. And I wondered this past week as I was studying this passage if the first one is really looking back at creation and what God has done and how our security is not in creation but the Creator. And the second one is sort of in the present, because we are in the city, right? We are in God's house. And then I look at the third one, and I thought, maybe this is a picture of the end. Maybe this is looking forward. I'm not original to this thought. I came across it in a couple places, but it's almost as if God inspires the sons of Korah to take the hearts of God's people who are in these troubles, and then points our eyes and hearts to the end. To the end of the story. Because in this image, we're reminded again of not only is the Christian life not exempt from trouble, even to the very end, but here's the end. On that day, there will only be one left standing, and his children with him. And he's the one who will bring everything to its end. He will bring the end to wars. He'll bring an end to all that causes the wars and the pain within them. He is the one who will put a stop to all of it. It's a powerful picture. An end to all that troubles us. Really, that's the whole point of the book of Revelation. Here's a letter written to a young church of believers. And I think of the young believers in Afghanistan today, and I think, man, the book of Revelation is written just for this moment. And it's a young church that's being tossed about by the one who stands opposed to all who stand in Christ. And the whole point of the book of Revelation, I remember there was a book published within our denomination, and I can't remember the name of the author, but it says the whole point is that God wins. God wins. And that's what I see when I look at these verses in verses 8 and 9. There's trouble still here, and it'll be here till the very end. But God wins. And he will be exalted. And every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, right? And then these words in verse 10, which have been for my own personal journey and our families and others, I mean, these words, right? Be still. Though I know I've said it here before, sometimes I fear that we sort of mute the power of those first two words. Sort of have this quiet scenery and moment in which God whispers, be still. But I think it's God yelling, if that's a word I could use about God. Or God firmly telling, be still. And know that I am God. Or as one person translated it, knock it off. Be still and know. Be still and know that Christ is King and he is the victor over sin's curse. Be still and know the trouble cannot shake the one who is our refuge. And though that trouble may seem larger than life, it will not separate us from the God who is for us. And though we cannot see what trouble the future will hold, we don't even know what the next hour is going to bring. Our hope is in the one who knows how the story is going to end. That's the peace and the joy isn't it? It's the peace and joy we pray will fill the hearts of believers in Afghanistan or wherever the name of Jesus is treated with derision and contempt. It's the peace, I hope, that fills our hearts and our lives as we prepare to go back to our homes this week, and for some of our students going back to school this week, and for some of us going back to work this week, and for all of us going back to our neighborhoods and our community. And we don't know what tomorrow will hold, but this is who we are. It's no small thing that Psalm 46, verse 10, has been a vital link of faith for followers of Jesus. It certainly has been in our own family. I don't often share deeply personal things, but today is August 22. Emily would have been 20 years old today. These are some pictures my wife put together in some beautiful books 20 years ago. 20 years ago, we became parents for the first time. And as many of you know, when Emily arrived, even before she arrived, there was some significant trouble. Prior to her birth, an ultrasound showed that the right side of her heart had not developed. And, to picture Psalmist here, the ground shook under our feet. It was Good Friday. We got that news. 5 days after Emily was born, she underwent open-heart surgery. It did not go well, but she survived, and a two-week stay at the hospital turned into a three-month stay due to a lot of medical complications. And then 4 years later, God carried her home. It still hurts. As Heather and I prayed together the night of her surgery, I remember distinctly, to pick up an image of Psalm 46, a sense of which the river of God's peace filled us in that moment as the trouble pressed down on us. And we knew by faith, just distinctly, we knew, no matter what happened, God was within us. There were tears, there still are, and then December 5, 2005, Jesus carried her home. And by faith we know, and we know this, right? We know this trouble of our tears and our sorrow and our grief will not last forever. It doesn't win. So on a page that Heather put together, this is a picture of us in the pediatric cardiothoracic unit, PCTU. At Mott's Children's Hospital, and Heather includes, "Be still. Know that I am God." When trouble comes, God is with us. He is with those who fear Him. He is with those who trust Him, and in Jesus, know that we are loved and forgiven. And that's why when trouble comes, and that's every day, we hear words like Psalm 46, and then we walk by faith and with peace and joy because God is with us. So we trust Him. And we fix our eyes on Jesus. And we're still. Whereas we're going to sing in this song, we could have sung "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God," but I wasn't feeling that for the service. But this hymn came to mind: "Be still, my soul, the Lord is on thy side. Bear patiently the cross of grief or pain. Leave to thy God to order and provide in every change." You could put the word "trouble" there. He faithful will remain. This is why we pray for the believers in Afghanistan today. We pray for them because they're in trouble because of their allegiance to Christ. And we pray for our brothers and sisters right next door to us whose life has been shaken somehow to the core. That's the first scenario. Or maybe they're in the midst of some dark days and the pressure around them is pretty immense. And that's the second scenario, right? Or there's the third one, And that is, like them, we long for the day when the trouble will be no more. And it's no small thing. The book of Revelation ends with that prayer. Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. And every tear will be wiped away. That day's not here yet. But we cling to the rock that cannot be moved. We cling to the one for whom the psalmist says, God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we thank you for the promise that comes in Jesus, who whispers and sometimes says it really strongly, be still. Be still. Pray, Father, that as we, as your children, come to church again this morning, we come because our need for you is so great and our tanks can be so empty and there is so much going on around us. Help the song of the sons of Korah here in Psalm 46 speak to us again so that we are not afraid when the troubles come and the world around us just shakes and the pressure can be so much and our longing for the day when it's no more rings in our hearts. We pray this for ourselves. We pray this for all who know and trust Jesus. And we pray that for this very reason, others would come to Christ and find the one who is our ever-present help in trouble. In his name, in Christ's name, we ask all of this. Amen. Be still, my soul. Let's stand and worship. So what do those who face trouble do? They turn to the God who is strong, who is our refuge. And we'll spend some time in prayer this morning. Let's continue to pray for healing for Dick Van Dam. Dick spent a few days at Bronson Hospital this week due to pneumonia. He was able to come home on Thursday. But let's keep Dick in our prayers. Continued prayers for Jean Vader. She remains at Bethesda Ranch for care, and we lift her up in prayer. I want to pray. We ought to pray for our students as they, some of them return to school this week, and our teachers and administrators and staff. And this morning, we know in the city of Kalamazoo, a procession is going to start at 11 o'clock for Sergeant Proxmire. I want to pray for that family and our city as well. And then finally, and there's so much more we could pray for, of course, but we want to pray for the country of Haiti, where not only did an earthquake hit last Saturday, but two tropical depressions and storms have come through, adding continued stress and strain on already a very fragile country. And thank you for your financial support for World Renew last Sunday, and those funds will be channeled toward the rebuilding and recovery effort. And then continued prayers for the country or nation of Afghanistan, where there's so much turmoil and distress now. We can't even fathom it. I know you see the pictures and our hearts break for it, but there's so much more. And the Church of Jesus Christ is called to pray, and we will do that. And let's spend some time in prayer. Please join me. Heavenly Father, today in magnificent gatherings of worship and in secret places under threat of persecution, the worldwide family of God lifts high the name of Jesus Christ. And we glorify you, O God, for the gift that you are our refuge. You are our strength, our ever-present help in times of trouble, the very God who says, "Be still and know." We praise you for every life gathered under the banner of Jesus Christ. And we thank you, Father, for the work of the Holy Spirit who convicts us of sin, who calls us to repentance, who leads us in the joy of trusting you. And so we pray this morning, and young and old alike, you would revive our fellowship with Christ and give us steady feet, that we would walk in your presence and in your truth. Lord, we pray this morning that by the power of the gospel, you would free us to trust you more and to fret less. Make us less shakable when shaky things are going on, and when we are shaking, help us to trust in the one who truly is unshakable. And so we ask, oh God, you will help us to accept bad news or disappointing news or joy-depleting news with a bend in our knees. Not with passive resignation, but with active surrender to the God who does all things well, the God in whom we worship this morning. Grant us enormous compassion, Jesus, to care for the least of these in our world. We pray for the yet to be born, for those who walk the same ground as we do every day. Show us how to care with a love that comes from you and sees beyond false barriers of race or ethnicity or status or economics. Father, we pray for the Kalamazoo community today. Today, Sergeant Proxmire will be laid to rest, and the tragedy and the travesty of his death weighs heavily on a city. We pray, O God, that in the midst of the grieving and mourning it happens today, that little glimmers and sightings of your comfort and grace would speak to every heart. We pray, O God, for this community of faith here at Heritage Church, for those who are grieving the loss of a loved one. We pray for those who are struggling with the loss of memory. God, we ask that you would draw near to those who are in need of healing, for Dick Van Dam and Tom Molinar, Bonnie Langland, Gene Vader. God, we pray for those who are facing challenging health concerns. As the world trembles under their feet, help them to know your peace. And God, we pray for those who know weary days and long for golden days. We pray for our world. Our hearts are heavy for the nation of Afghanistan, where turmoil and political unrest has created a situation that is dire. And not just for the church there, but no less for it. Give them your peace and joy in the midst of the shaking and the pressure and the longing. We pray for the nation of Haiti, where natural disasters has caused increased havoc on a nation that is barely held together because of so much trouble. Be with the church in that country. And be with all the nations. Lord, it's just a reminder again that we need your help. We need renewed hope. And we need ultimately the one in whom that hope is found. So we pray, God, this morning that you would turn the hearts of people in every tribe and nation and tongue to seek the one who is seeking them. And through your Holy Spirit, may many come to a saving knowledge of Jesus, for whom the cross has said, I will be with you forever. And all of this, O God, may your name be praised here in this place and wherever we go. And as we leave this place this morning, free us to serve you this week with gladness, because we know our life belongs to you. We ask this in the name of the one who is our King and Lord. He is Jesus, the one who is and who was and who is to come. Amen. A couple of announcements this morning as we continue our service here. We have our Heritage Happenings. Encourage you to check out some of the ministry updates happening here in regard to our fall ministry programs. You'll find that on the inside. This newsletter is available online at our website as well, about some of our small group ministries and some plans for the coming months. So be sure to be aware of that. Notes here as well. Our coffee break ladies are planning to meet first time on Tuesday, September 7th, and there's a sign-up sheet available. Sign up if you're interested so they know how much material to come and order for those events. And I know there's movement happening for our men's ministry and others. They're going to start meeting as well. So be sure to check out our Heritage Happenings. This coming Saturday is the monthly mobile food initiative. And the good news is, although if you love volunteering, maybe this isn't, but they don't need us this Saturday, because Centerpoint, one of the partner churches, has been able to find two small groups that are going to help, and so they have 12 or 13 people lined up. Though, not that I don't trust them, but I would like it if maybe one or two or three could come. So, you know, if you are really like, man, the Holy Spirit's telling me I got to serve on Saturday morning, come and let me know, okay? Because that way we can help with that morning event of our mobile food initiative. Our offering this morning is a ministry that is about our congregation, but also about the kingdom of God. And we know that many universities and colleges around the nation, Christian colleges as well, are beginning to meet this week. And our kingdom initiative will be for Calvin University, established oh so long ago. I think we have many graduates here in this context. And our loose change offering, all of it will be received at the doors on the way out, will go to support Calvin University. Invite you to stand as we come to the close of our service this morning. It's not a question of if, it's a matter of when the trouble comes. Psalm 46 becomes a word for his people. God says, I'm your refuge. I'm the one who is within you. I'm the one who's got this. Be still. And people of God, as you go from this place, receive also God's blessing as you journey into whatever troubles may continue once you leave this place, whichever ones may come new to you. In all of it, receive God's blessing, and we'll close by singing, Salvation belongs to our God. Receive God's blessing. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, and has made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and power forever and ever. And together God's people say, Amen.